some great discussions already, basically from comrades on both sides. A general overview of what's common in these struggles and two specific case studies of some of the most inspiring uprisings that we've seen in the past year or so. I want to take a slightly different perspective and look at what happens after these uprisings and the immediate wake of them and what we do in a time of general demobilization, some of the challenges that we face as movements and what we can do about them, hopefully. I was told that the title for this panel, Contemporary Uprisings in a World That Is Dying for a World That's Being Born, was a creation by John Holloway, who could unfortunately not be here. He was supposed to be here. But when I saw this title, it actually reminded me of a saying by Antonio Gramsci. And he added something to the title that's very similar, when he wrote in one of Mussolini's fascist prison cells that the old world is dying and the new one struggles to be born. Now is the time of monsters. So I would say that we live in a similar state of limbo today between an old world that is dying and a new world that's struggling to be born. As we saw on day one of this festival, we see all kinds of morbid symptoms arising in this interregnum. We see the rise of fascism, new totalitarianisms, and we have to confront some very serious questions for ourselves about how to take the struggle forward in this time of monsters. So basically what I want to do is problematize this title of this panel a little bit and ask, first of all, is the old world really dying? If so, why? And if not, why not? And second of all, why is it that the new world is struggling so hard to be born? What is inhibiting its birth? And finally, what are we to make of the recent uprisings in light of the answers to the previous question? So in one way, we can say that the old world is dying all around us. We live in an era of financialization in which capital is struggling, especially here in Europe, to find the kind of profitable investment opportunities to keep reproducing itself. And at the same time, the representative institutions of liberal democracy and the nation state are facing a very deep legitimation crisis. Well, we've seen it in Latin America, we've seen it in countries of North Africa and the Middle East. And of course, this has been intensified as a result of the recent financial crisis. And we can say that in this sense, the old world is dying. In another more sinister way, however, we should recognize that the old world is also thriving. It continues to exist, it's all around us, and it seems so strong at times that it seems absolutely impossible to defeat it. And I think one of the paradigmatic moments for me personally was to witness what happened here in Greece, in Athens, on February 12, 2012, during a 48-hour general strike, when 500,000 people marched on Parliament after 2 years of intense confrontations with the state, after 2 years, or 3 years almost, of extreme austerity measures, and now another memorandum being pushed through by Troika and the unelected technocratic government of Lukas Papadimos. It's really incredible to see that on a night when 45 buildings were set ablaze, when plumes of smoke were billowing above the city, you know, when even grannies were telling anarchists where to bomb the next bank next door, you know, if something like this had happened in my home country, in the Netherlands, so the newspapers would have screamed revolution on the front page the next day. But here, the next day, while the banks lay still smoldering, everything just went on, as if nothing had ever happened. So what does this tell us? I mean, it's very clear that, you know, we can burn the banks, we can confront the police, and we can attack Parliament, but the real power is no longer there. We live in an era of globalized financial capitalism, as we heard in the first talk and as we all know, and there's no winter palace to store. There's no centralized political symbol to see. As the Italian philosopher Bifo puts it, what's different today is that we can no longer face our enemy face to face in the street. We can no longer confront him or her or it physically in the territory. So the problem we face is that we're actually up against transnational flows of capital. We're up against international decisions being made in foreign. And how do we fight this within the territorial realm to which we are necessarily confined as human beings? So for this reason, rather than simply, you know, taking the fact as a self-evident truth that the old world is dying, I think we have to be very honest and critical with ourselves and see that the old world may in fact already be dead, but it continues to sort of, you know, lumber around us as a kind of lifeless zombie capitalism that feeds ever more aggressively in the social body and the commonwealth in order to sustain itself, and that takes crisis as a mode of government in which crisis is no longer a threat to the continued existence of the system, but in which it becomes the very logic by which it reproduces itself. So the conclusion that I think people around the world are reaching, people within the movements are reaching on a very large scale now, is that capitalism and the state are not simply going to go away until we manage to actually construct an organized counterpower that can truly challenge it at the different levels at which it exists, and that includes the local, the national, the regional, the continental, and the global level of life. So that brings us to the second question, is a new world really being born? I don't know if it's being born, but I like what Eduardo Galeano said in Barcelona in 2011 when he was interviewed at Plaza Catalunya. He said that this shitty world is pregnant with a new one, but the labor to give birth to it will be very hard. And I think this is the terms in which we have to think, as a beginning. We have the seedling, we have an embryonic existence, and now there is going to be very hard labor to actually bring it into existence. So the question is why? And the most obvious and most immediate answer is that there's been an extremely violent state crackdown. We've seen it here in Greece with the eviction of the squares, but we've also seen it in Spain with a series of anti-protest laws. We've seen it very extremely in Egypt with an extremely bloody crackdown on the Muslim Brotherhood and anti-coup protesters, but also anti-protest laws that now prohibit secular protesters from taking to the streets. We've seen it in Turkey with a very violent assault after the Gezi uprising and the Soma disaster. We've seen it in Brazil with the militarization of police and the pacification schemes of the favelas. We've seen it in the United States with the federal crackdown on Occupy, and more recently the disproportionate violence of heavily militarized police in Ferguson. But I think at the same time it would be very dangerous to sort of consider this state violence as the only challenge that we face. And there are actually forms and mechanisms of control that are much less visible but much more pervasive in the social fabric. And it's actually these mechanisms, these less visible ones, that I think we have to identify, we have to understand, and we have to disarm. And this we can only do by first of all starting to investigate them, and then through collaborative processes to try to understand what we can do about them. And while there's obviously a multiplicity of control mechanisms that we could identify, there's some that we've tried to focus on in Uproar, and some that I personally think are very important that I want to shine a light on. They're by no means exclusive or complete, but there are three things that I think are very important to focus on. The first is atomicity, the second is anxiety, and the third is futility. So atomicity would refer to the fact that under neoliberalism, both the opposition to capital and the social fabric more generally are deeply fragmented. And a lot of this has to do with the transformation of work and the restructuring of the process of capital accumulation under a financialized regime. David Graeber, for instance, has shown very brilliantly in his book Debt, the First 5,000 Years, how indebtedness tends to have an individualizing effect on people. It tends to isolate people and make people feel guilty and not seek the kind of community that would make them feel like they're part of something bigger. And, precarious nature of employment, of course, does the exact same thing. So because neoliberalism atomizes the social fabric, it makes it much more difficult to organize collective action at a large scale. It makes it much more difficult to build lasting forms of organization that can actually withstand the ephemeral nature of protest. So what we, in a way, end up doing within the movements unwittingly is to sort of reproduce this atomization, not through any fault of our own, but simply through the logic of the world that we inhabit. It's very important to sort of try to disarm this and see how we can go about in going against these dynamics. And the question of atomicity is in turn very closely connected to the question of anxiety. Anxiety is a subjective experience, and I would say that today many people are feeling very anxious, because not just because we have a debt to pay off or because we cannot find a job, but also because we feel a constant need and a constant urge to prove ourselves and improve ourselves in order to be fit for a career, in order to stand opportunities to make it within the market, in order to be able to keep our jobs. And of course this goes to differing extents for different individuals, but as Foucault had very brilliantly shown, under neoliberalism we tend to become entrepreneurs of the self. And we internalize this very logic of becoming successful even if we do not desire to be successful as such. The Institute for Precarious Consciousness recently published a very interesting essay in which it was called We Are All Very Anxious, in which they argued that anxiety is the dominant effect, the dominant subjective experience under financialized capitalism. As a result of the precarious nature of employment. And they tried to show how by maintaining individuals atomized and in a constant state of paralyzation on the verge of a permanent nervous breakdown, anxiety serves to prevent the emergence of political militancy. And finally,
finally beyond this atomicity and this anxiety, neoliberalism has asserted very direct control of our imagination, something that Haven has shown very well in two recent books, actually, by convincing us that there is no alternative and that all resistance is futile.
So what does this tell us in terms of the uprisings? How should we look at them in the context of these challenges? I would say that the only way to understand them is as a beginning, the beginning of a long-term process. And perhaps the rebirth of what Cornelius Castoriadis famously called the project of autonomy. This is a long-term process. But at the same time, there are certain things that cannot wait for very long term, as we've already heard before and as most of us know. There are immediate challenges that we face. So it seems that we need to divide our organizational priorities between different temporalities, between those of immediate needs and immediate defenses that need to be made now within this present moment, and those that can actually only take place on a much more long-term duration, and where we actually have to decouple from capitalist time, which constantly forces us to keep running faster and faster, and take that step back and say, okay, you know, let's set our own time to build our own institutions and not be rushed into anything overly fast. So all of this ultimately comes back to the question of organization and the question of strategies in different temporalities. And I think that we have to be very careful because the moment that we give up on organization, we leave the field to the organized forces, which tend to be reformist or fascist. So it's very important that grassroots movements are organized at large scales. And this is the challenge that we will face in the coming years. It's pessimism of the intellect, optimism of the will. And we know that we may never win, but we are still convinced that we can. And on that note, I would like to end it.